connecting with nature, with love and devotion, a trusting companion, built high on emotion, a good horse and rider, patiently trained.
In 1926, Purina established this working farm in Gray Summit, Missouri, to support product development and feed trials. Today it's known as the Purina Animal Nutrition Center. This season of riding horses, we've got a four-year-old granddaughter, Playgun, that was born and raised there, that we're going to use to give you an in-depth, week-to-week look at our approach with our horses. Her name is Holly Seven Petals. We call her Miss Purina. Purina has been the number one reason our horses have stayed healthy and sound over the last 10 years. So for me to have this opportunity to use one of the horses that they've had at their farm for research is pretty special to me. So join us as we introduce Miss Purina to this new chapter in her life and let you see her transformation through our program. Our horses work hard for us every day, so nutrition is a major concern. I've relied on Purina horse feed products for over 12 years. Purina is always on the leading edge of research and nutrition innovation, and with their feed guard system, I know I can rely on the safety and quality of their products from coast to coast. No matter what you do with your horse, Purina has the right product for you. Visit horse.purinamills.com or find them on Facebook for more information. Welcome to this week's episode of Riding Horses. All right, we've got a little two-year-old filly here today that I'm gonna walk you guys through what I'm looking for in my young horses when we're starting one. Now this filly, she's been here for a little while. We've been helping the owner get her started, and I was hoping to have some stuff videoed with her before now, showing up to now, but it hasn't worked out to get it on film. So I'm just gonna go with this filly with where she's at today, but I want you guys to think about this. I have certain criteria that I'm trying to get these horses to meet as far as what they're comfortable with. I'm still aware of the places where they're not comfortable, but more than anything, what I'm trying to remind myself is it doesn't matter how fast I can crawl on one. And if all I'm doing is trying to go at my horses to see how quick I can teach them to stop and turn around and all that stuff, but I don't really help these horses learn to relax and get comfortable and confident with what I'm doing, then all I'm going to do is I'm going to end up with a horse that, as I'm trying to progress through my training, I've got a horse that's constantly looking over their shoulder, so to speak. This filly, when she came here, she was barely halter broke. She had very little handling, and she was a handful for a while. It took quite a while just to get her where we could catch her consistently. This mare has worked a lot of hours in the round pen on the ground, a lot of hours with me saddling and unsaddling. And I've got all my stuff over here that we've been using just to help this mare learn to relax first and foremost. You can see it's hot out here today. It's not gonna be long. This shirt I'm wearing is gonna be a different color. So hopefully as I start sweating, you guys will have a little bit, or maybe as much sympathy for me as you will this horse if she starts sweating a little bit. Now, this is just a bottle of fly spray, and as crazy as this sounds, between that tarp and that ball and my flags and my ropes, all the stuff I've brought out here, nothing has bothered this mare more than this bottle of fly spray. In fact, I've got another bottle in my tack room that's just water, and I've worn the sprayer out on that bottle just spraying this mare down with water so I wasn't wasting my fly spray. So I'm gonna go ahead and start with this since these flies are biting her pretty good. As I start spraying this, I want you guys to see that she's not just gonna stand here and go to sleep just yet. But she's way better than she used to be. How much time do I need to invest getting my horse comfortable with a bottle of fly spray? Well, I can tell you this, the first time I tried to spray this mare on the front legs and she was trying to paw this bottle out of my hand, I would say as much time as it takes to get her where, excuse me, to get her where my son could come spray her. This mare goes home, and it's not me the one that's working her or me the one that's riding her. The owner is going to want to have a horse that has some confidence in what she's going to be asking it to do and not be worried about whether or not she's going to do something that's going to scare this little horse. I've sat on a lot of horses trying to buck me off. And if my horse is bucking out of playfulness, my horse is bucking out of disrespect, or my horse is bucking out of fear, of all three of those, the last one I want is my horse bucking out of fear. Because if a horse is scared of what you're doing and they're trying to get rid of you, I can promise you they're going to add a little bit more effort to it. Because in their mind, they might be doing it just to try to save their life. And that's pretty much how this mare was. Everything I did with her, this is all stuff, just using the tail end of my lead rope. We walked through all of this with Miss Purina when we started her to give you guys a chance to see some of the groundwork that we're doing just to build some confidence in these horses with the noise and the movement. I have done nothing different with this filly than we did with Miss Purina, other than I've probably added a few more hours to it. Excuse me. If it took me 30 minutes with Purina to get her where I could flip this lead rope over, all over her body, it probably took 4 hours on this filly. And she wasn't standing here like this. In the process, she was moving around that pin, or round pin, basically just in a manner where she was trying to get away from it, you know, as if she's trying to save her hide. Excuse me. Hopefully I can get rid of that cough. Now, this isn't your typical flag. Usually I'm using a flag more like this. I'll take this string off this one, where we'll tie one of these sacks on the end of our sticks. And again, this was probably number two on the list for this mare as far as what she was really, really bothered by. When I'm spraying this mare anywhere in this area with that bottle of fly spray, or actually with that bottle of water, she just reach up and try to knock it out of my hand. And she was the same way with this flag down in here. So again, it's not that I compare these horses, but if I did look back at the time it took Miss Purina to get comfortable with this flag versus this mare, you could sure add a few more hours to it. Probably a little bit more sweat. Meaning, when I approach one, I want to be in an environment where they can move around. To have one stand quiet and relax like this is good, but really what I'm more concerned about than anything is these horses learning to relax while they're moving. So while she's bothered, she moved around our little round pen a ton. The good thing about that movement was if I'd give her a place to go and let her move her feet while she was trying to convince herself, or I could say while she was allowing me to try to convince her that this flag on the stick wasn't going to eat her, with all the forward motion she had, it made it a lot harder for her to be striking at it. This is a little flag that we use to flag ropings with. You wouldn't think it's much, but I'm telling you what, if you've never flagged a roping off of a horse before, something as simple as that. Again, for this mare, it was a big deal to start with. All this stuff I plan on taking with me when I get on her. And this is what I want you guys to see. If you want to know where your horse should be at before you crawl on, I just need to ask myself, what is it I'm going to do once I get up there? I've kind of got a list in my mind of the things that I want them comfortable with. And I'm not saying they've got to be 100%, but I will say this, if they're acting like they're trying to kill me because they're not sure they can survive what I'm doing, that's a pretty good indication to me that I haven't done it enough. You get to a rope and you're just holding that rascal up. It's quiet. And then it just comes down like that. Again, for an older horse, you wouldn't think this would be a big deal. In fact, just standing out here with this simple little flag in your hand, you wouldn't think it'd be a big deal for any of them. But I promise you, this little flag right here could get a lot of people bucked off. This mare hasn't been ridden much, but she's getting really, really good at finding places to relax now while I'm up there making a lot of noise and a lot of movement. And once she's consistent with that, then when somebody starts working on a little bit more feel, a little bit more direction through their reins, trying to control her a little bit more steering, using your legs a little bit, all that stuff becomes a whole lot easier once these horses are past that frame of mind where they're still, about the best way I can describe it is when they're still trying to protect themselves. So if I could come out here every day and have this frame of mind, then I'm thinking I've gained a lot of ground. And again, if I look back at how many hours it's taken me to get to this point with this mare, it hadn't been easy. She hadn't given it up easy. And there's been times I've walked out of my round pen dirtier and sweatier than she did. But guys, this right here is the ticket. This is the goal for all of our horses before we think about, okay, if they've got the potential to go work a cow, if they've got the potential to be a reining horse, whatever that might be, if they've got the potential to be a roping horse, the fundamentals of that discipline that we're going to teach them are secondary to this frame of mind right here. So I'm going to drag out some more of this stuff. I'll drag out this tarp and this ball and show you guys what I was doing with that up to this point, but we're going to give her just a few minutes, so stay tuned. We'll be right back.
Riding horses each day is a horse lover's dream.
With all the hauling and training we do each year, we put a lot of stress on our horses. Since adding Forco to our feeding program to help maintain the digestive system, our horses have never looked better, acted better, or performed as well as they do now. We are very excited to be bringing on board Lisa's Western Wear in Pratt, Kansas, as a new team member here at Kerry Kuhn Horsemanship. Lisa's Western Wear has the latest in Western fashions for men and women. They have a great selection of jeans, shirts, boots, hats, children's apparel, jewelry, Western style home decor, as well as a full line of ropes and tack. They also carry the snaffle and transition bits that we use in our program that we feel are so important in building that proper foundation. So if you're looking for something Western, check them out at lisaswesternwear.com, or if you're in the area, be sure to stop in and see them. All right, guys, welcome back to this week's episode. I wish I could say I brought this ball out here just for me to sit on. There's been many a moments that I've been sitting in the round pen on this rascal just trying to relax and catch my breath, because this ball for this mare was a pretty big deal once I brought this thing to life. Now, it's nothing but an object, a Okay, this doesn't have to be much different than my saddle pad, doesn't have to be much different than my saddle. Now granted, the first time I came out here and showed it to her, you'd have thought it was an alligator. Getting it up on her, yeah, she moved her feet a lot before she finally let me put it up on her. But the main reason I wanted this ball was for this. This movement right here. Anything that moved quick around this mare, like if I was walking up to her and I just stepped a little bit harder with one stride than the other, I mean, this mare just spook and leave. The thought of me coming up here beside her, when I crawl on a horse, I don't like to just pull myself up there dead weight. So in my mind, I'm thinking, what do I need to be doing with my horses to get them prepared for me to get on? I bounce in my stirrup, and I bounce to the point where I'm trying to get some life flowing through my body. So once I get that life to come up, then I just let it kind of carry me up on that horse. Well, for me to stand beside her and jump up and down, I couldn't do that in the beginning without getting my head kicked off. So I just bring this ball out here and bounce this rascal around. And it's taken some time to get her to the point where we could stand here next to her or get her where I could bounce this rascal off of her. I mean, basically, I'm just learning to dribble this ball here, this spot here, just like the flag, just like that spray bottle, that fly spray, that spot. You didn't see me spending a lot of time there in the beginning. I couldn't stay there without getting pawed. And not that this mare was trying to be necessarily aggressive. She was just really, really unsure of stuff right in this area. And that's just the manner in which she thought she needed to react to it to get rid of it. This little simple ball, just being able to do this right here, has now given me the freedom to be able to crawl on without getting myself kicked while I'm getting on. Again, it's nothing more than an object, and I'll use it as such, just like this. But my main goal with this ball was to bring it to life when I'm just bouncing it around, dribbling it around, just to help introduce her to that life and that energy that I'm gonna have. While I'm trying to crawl on. Now this tarp thing, this mare was really, really sensitive to the noise and movement. And once she got moving, if that noise and movement stayed with her at all, she just tried to outrun it. And man, she'd get going pretty fast. So yeah, we spent some time with this tarp. Now I don't know if the wind's gonna let me do it here. We spent a little time with this tarp on the ground, trying to get this mare to cross it. But again, that wasn't my initial purpose for bringing this tarp out here. The noise and movement that this thing can bring into the picture as far as preparing this filly to make some changes in her mind to carry a rider, man, this thing is profound. Obviously, when I started, I had this rascal rolled up where I could just rub her with it. Again, there wasn't very many things that I brought out here that she wasn't trying to paw at. Other than she never did paw at my saddle, but by the time I brought my saddle out, she'd already made some pretty good changes in her mind. So I went through all of this, just wadding this thing up then I unfolded it just a little bit. Now I'm going to unfold it pretty big here because she's been carrying this thing around. So again, if I'm thinking about what I wanted this tarp to really help me with, wasn't so much to just get her where she'd stand still. What I wanted this tarp to help me with more than anything was while she was moving. So I'll just get her walking around me here. I might have to go ahead and put the saddle on to show you how this would work. Because I think the wind's going to try to blow this thing off. But I would get this filly moving around me and I'd hold this tarp out here. In fact, I sure couldn't stand this close to her in the beginning. When I'd pick this tarp up, if she was carrying it like that, it was kind of eventful. So what I did was I took my lunge line and I just put a loop around this where I could stand further away. And while she's trotting around there, once I got her to the point where she could carry this and I could leave it up there with the saddle and not worry about her panicking to the point where she'd hurt herself, then I'd stand out here and I'd just pick this thing up and let it fall like this. But it wasn't just, guys, I can't just bring this tarp out to a horse that's never been exposed to it, saddle him up and tie this tarp to him for the first time. I spent a lot of time with this tarp in my hand with it not tied on. I'd get it up there and I'd have it as best I could in my hand, probably standing more like out here, get her to take a few steps. She'd take two or three steps and then she'd just bolt. And I'd have to keep the tarp with me in the beginning because I didn't feel like she was prepared enough yet for me to leave that tarp on there and her be, in my mind, her not panic so much that she'd go run into my round pen and hurt herself. Lots of hours, guys, just trying to get her where I could do that. I had this tarp again with my lunge line tied to it and I'd drag it beside her, kind of drag it on the ground. Let her get used to it and then I'll kind of show you guys once I get the saddle on her. Then I'd take that lunge line and go up over my saddle horn and send her and get that tarp way back there. Back far enough that it really wasn't bothering, and just little by little I'd bring it closer up to her till she could carry it. But what this tarp did, guys, it's hard for me, you can probably hear it in this microphone, the noise and movement that this tarp makes, it's hard for me as a rider, just by myself, if I don't have anything in my hands, it's really hard for me to make as much noise as this thing does. And as this thing gets to flopping around, waving around, if your horse gets to trotting around or loping around, a lot of noise and a lot of movement. What I wanted to know was, could this filly get comfortable enough with all that noise and movement happening right in here, both sides, before I just crawl up here and stay, so she's not looking back over her shoulder, seeing me move around, thinking, there's no way in the world I can survive this, and off she goes. Like I say, I wish we'd have had some of the footage. We've got that roan horse that we filmed with a week or so ago. We'll try to get it set up as we take him through all this, where you guys can see more of the process to get to this point. Excuse me. because this mare was nothing like this when we started. I'm just going to roll this lead rope around her here a couple times, and then we'll bring her saddle out here and get her saddled up. You know, you guys have seen me do that a lot over the years with a lot of different horses. The feel of this rope down here around their butt, learning to follow their nose, getting them horses where they're not scared of that rope back there. And then when you're dealing with a horse, a green horse like this, that's really sensitive and uncomfortable with some of this stuff that's new to her, for this horse to make this transition right here, she's in a position right there where she can only see me out of that right eye. And when she makes this turn here, right there she lost me, there she picks me up in the left eye. So getting that horse to make that transition from one eye to the other, again, that's a big deal. And I have sat on many colts in the past that weren't comfortable making that transition. And when that horse, when you're sitting on a colt like that and that colt looks back and sees you out of his left eye and you can feel him get tight and tense, here's the problem. You don't want to turn loose of that left rein because you know when you let his head get straight enough that now he picks you up out of that right eye, you know it's not going to be good. So you sit there and you hold that nose tipped over there, and then you're trying to ask yourself, all right, he's not bucking me off right now because of how he's looking at me in this left eye, but man, as that head starts to go back straight, I feel him getting tighter and tighter. What's going to happen when that horse picks me up out of that other eye? And that little exercise right there can be huge for a horse like that. We're going to give her another short break. Stay tuned. We'll be right back and get her saddled.
Riding horses each day is a horse lover's dream.
We've been riding CSI saddle pads for close to 12 years. This custom pad was made for us in 2005, and with probably close to 10,000 hours of use on it, you can clearly see how well they hold up. With their flex plate designed to disperse uneven saddle pressure and their interchangeable Velcro system, these saddle pads will fit any horse and offer superb protection. So if you're serious about keeping your horse sound and comfortable, you need to let CSI saddle pads have your horse's back. The Kerry Kuhn training halter is designed to eliminate the rolling effect from a lateral pull to help keep your halter in place at all times. With sliding rings to ride with, it works with the rider to pinpoint pressure where it will help the most. Welcome back, guys. All right, as we're talking about getting these young horses, these green horses, ready for a rider, every one of us ought to be asking ourselves, what's the first thing that's probably going to get me hurt when I crawl on one? Is it my horse not knowing what I'm asking them to do? Or is it my horse getting scared because of something I did that they weren't comfortable with yet? And then the horse just reacted to it. Next thing you know, I'm laying on the ground because they bolted and ran off and bucked me off. So all this stuff that I drag out here with this filly, I'm going to go ahead and get her saddled. I'm looking at every one of my colts the same way. Again, this filly doesn't belong to us. But I'm going to go at her the same way I would my own. If you've sat on enough horses that were... And man, I've watched some guys do it. Shoot, I used to, when I was traveling around doing those expos starting colts, if I think about that environment, all I was doing was showing those horses just enough to get them where they'd let me take the next step. But I'll promise you, I crawled up on many of them colts, and when my butt hit that saddle right there, now all of a sudden I'm a lot more aware of all those holes that I hadn't filled in yet. And I'm starting to become more and more excited about helping people see the approach we really ought to be after. Yeah, you can get a lot of things done with a horse in a short amount of time. But you know what? A young horse that's had two rides, they don't know a whole lot. The steering isn't very good. But them rascals ought to be relaxed enough that you could put a kid on them. Now, I'm not telling you to go home and throw your kids up on your young colts that have had two rides. But I'm saying I want my horse in a frame of mind where they're quiet enough and relaxed enough that if somebody was sitting up there just as green as they are, just as green as the horse is, it's not going to cause a big issue. Granted, that horse might not follow that green rider's direction very good because their timing might be a little off. But man, getting them horses just far enough along. I'm going to go ahead and turn her here so you can watch me pull these cinches up. Now, even with this saddle, this whole saddling process sure didn't look like this in the beginning. I can't tell you how many times them cinches dangling down there scared her and caused her to go jumping sideways or trying to jump out from under the saddle. I think back to that roan horse we used a week or so ago for some filming. I kind of look at it this way. This mare being so sensitive and so reactive because she's scared of all this new stuff, you'll see her move around here a little bit as I'm pulling these cinches up. I'm not going to make a big deal out of that, guys. If you had any idea where I had to start from with that, that right there is pretty nice. Over time, every day this mare gets a little bit better. But there was days where I'd saddle her and unsaddle her six times just to go through the process, because she was so cinchy. There's no sense in dealing with a horse 2 years down the road that's still cinchy. Why don't we address that in the beginning to where we don't end up with something that struggled with it in the beginning, and because we never helped them with it, we leave that thought there in that horse's mind, and every day that thought just grows a little bit bigger and a little bit bigger and a little bit bigger, and next thing you know, it's become a habit to the point where now we got a six-year-old horse that's still cinchy. Now, I'm going to be somewhat careless with a little bit of this stuff because I want you guys to see to the point in which I'm trying to get my young horses relaxed. You know, I mentioned to you guys what I did with this lunge line. Let me go ahead and grab it and I'll show you. You know, that first week of saddling this mare up, it wasn't uncommon if I cinched her up six times that day, meaning took the saddle off, put it back on, pulled the cinch back up. She'd buck about every time. Just jump around there a little bit. All I was doing along the way was asking myself, how many times am I going to have to pull this saddle off and show it to this filly before she gets comfortable and quiet and doesn't feel like she has to react that way? Now, what I would do while she was bucking, I wasn't trying to get after her for it. What I just made sure I did was I kept her moving, okay? If she wanted to buck, it seemed like I would just kind of step in there and ask for more forward and just try to get her thinking about going forward and not going up quite so much. Now, so I would take my lunge line like so and just have it looped over my saddle horn. And I'd get this mare going around the round pin. To the point where this tarp was following. But again, far enough away that it really wasn't bothering her too much. And little by little, I would just pull it up to her. Dragon, log, whatever it might be. The good thing about this scenario, now I gotta be aware of Miss Purina back there tied to the fence. She's not tied solid. But if I thought this mare was gonna be so reactive that I'd get that mare in trouble, I wouldn't have Purina in here with us. So she'd carry this thing around, but at any time, I could drop this rope. Or roll this thing up there over my saddle horn and just let this fall. She's not 100% with this yet, which is why I'm doing it. I want you guys to see the fact that she still needs some help with that. But my gosh, you think about the older horses, the broke horses that we have been riding for years. And if I tried to do something like that with them, I wonder what it'd look like. That's a pretty big deal, guys. I just look at it this way. Am I serious about helping this mare change her train of thought to the point where she's not so bothered? Am I serious about helping this mare, as I've said in the past, make that paradigm shift to the point where she's not so reactive to every little thing? Again, this is not tied solid to this filly. I can let go of this, and pretty soon that rope's just going to come off there, and the tarp's going to stay put. Has there been times like what I had just a second ago? Oh yeah, she had times like that. All I was trying to do was get her, like I said, get her prepared to the point where I could challenge her a little bit without getting her hurt. That's the spot right there. Okay, that's the spot right there. If you think what I'm doing with this filly is too much, then I might say, go get your 10-year-old gelding that you've been riding for 8 years and ask the same thing from him. Because what you might see is where this filly's at right now is a fraction of what your older horse might show if you tried to do something like that. So then I found myself right here. What that is right there, guys, that's an extension of my arm. Okay, but that's a pretty exaggerated arm right there. There's no way in the world that my right arm could be that long and make this much noise and movement unless I had something in my hand. If I could get this filly where I could do this with this flag or this tarp, then for me to crawl up there and move my arms around, this filly just go to sleep. There was a time in my life where I was really interested in how fast I could get a saddle on one and how quick I could get on them. Just gonna go ahead and let her play with this for a minute. As I pick that up, then I let it back out. Her conditioned response in the beginning, guys, was quite a bit more than that. That's putting a lot on one, but that's saying, to me, that's saying to a horse like this, what's the point in me crawling up there if every time you look back, you're gonna try to outrun me, you're gonna try to buck me off? Why don't I just try to set it up in a scenario where I don't have to worry about riding you through all that bucking nonsense and getting thrown off and making matters worse, and I can give you some time to work on that frame of mind. All I did for motivation, guys, I'm telling you, she made lap after lap after lap after lap around that round pin, just trying to figure out, this isn't quite as bad as I thought. And once she'd worked at it long enough, she'd start to relax, then I'd take it away. Like to be able to take that with me when I get on. Again, to the point, if I can get her prepared for that, a rider will be a day off. Good job, Mom. So, it's kind of a quick process of showing you guys the frame of mind that I'm after with that ball over there with this tarp, as you've seen me do with so many other horses with my ropes and stuff. But again, if I look back at all the horses that I've trained for people that, in my mind, I was still trying to figure this stuff out, where I missed the mark to the point I sent those horses home, and my goal was to get them horses stopping and turning more so than anything else. And if you've got a short time frame, 30 days, 60 days, 90 days, and you're trying to cram that down a horse's throat, and you start skipping steps along the way so you can get up there and have more time to spend pulling on them horses, teach them how to get in the ground. Horse like this, or horse like the roan horse that we're gonna bring back out and film some more with, all you're gonna do with them horses is you're gonna take advantage of them. And then as those horses spend more and more time around you and you don't address this particular issue they have, it's almost like they start to develop a lack of trust because of your approach and skipping that particular point, then it's harder to ever build that back. I'm gonna give this mare a little break here, let her gather her thoughts. So you guys stay tuned, we'll be right back.
Riding horses each day is a horse lover's dream.
Hi, I'm Kerry Kuhn. If you own horses, you're familiar with fly problems. Shoe fly leggings are the best fly protection you'll find because they protect the most valuable part of your horse, their legs. Their simple and easy to use design helps to reduce stress on the joints, muscles, and tendons by preventing painful fly bites on the lower legs, which keeps your horse from standing around stomping all day. Made from a flexible plastic mesh, they do not restrict blood flow or range of motion and allow plenty of air circulation. So if you're looking for fly protection that has your horse's health in mind, shoe fly leggings is your best answer. Our horses wear them, you'll want your horses to wear them too. So check out your local feed or tack store, or for more information, go to shoeflyleggings.com. Our horsemanship company keeps us out on the road all year long. We can't afford to be broke down along the highway with a trailer load of horses. Nothing keeps our trucks running better and saves us money with less frequent oil changes than BG oil products. Find your nearest BG oil product dealer today so you can enjoy the BG advantage. Thank you guys for tuning in this week. You know, if you watch this, I'm sure it probably looks like a recap of so many other horses that we've worked with. But what this little mare has reminded me at this point in my life with all the horses I've had my hands on is just how important it is to this particular horse right here that I approach this filly in a manner that says, I'm more concerned about how you think about things than just how you act towards them. So whether it was the tarp or the ball or whatever it was that I brought into the round pen to help this filly relax, there was a time where it was a mess. What you saw me do with this tarp and this lunge line up over my saddle horn, I don't recommend you just run out and do it. Now, I know I mentioned go home and get your 10-year-old gelding and try it. You'll get yourself killed if your horse isn't prepared for that and you don't know how to set it up. It can be ugly. So we're going to, this mare's past that point, but I'm going to make sure we use this roan horse to film the process of what that looks like to get one to this point and even better. So you guys have some better knowledge of how to set that up without getting yourself hurt. Windy day, things flopping around. Welcome to the real world. So I think this filly, if I just kind of set that up and say, you guys use this for your gauge. Can I do some of these things? Can I do all these things on my young horses, on my green horses, my horses that have been ridden for a week? And if you can't, I strongly encourage you to go back and look at the frame of mind this mare is starting to carry and say, you know what? If I'd go help my colts find some of that, I'm not only making it safer for myself, I'm making it safer for my horse. And you're setting that horse up to progress faster in their training once you've established that trust and confidence. So I'm excited to see what this little filly turns out to be. If you guys will tune in next week, we're going to pick up right where we left off right here and ride her and take some of these objects with you and show her the process of what that looks like. So be sure and tune in next week.
Whoa, let's ride some horses, but remember they need a leader to trust and to help them succeed. Oh, let's ride some horses that look in their eye. So saddle me up and let's go for a ride.
Say goodbye to the folks, Patch. Good boy.